This is the Catholic Daily Mass Readings and Reflections for Sunday of the 13th week in Ordinary Season. Today's first reading is from Wisdom, chapter 1, verses 13 to 15, and chapter 2, verses 23 to 24. The second reading is from 2 Corinthians, chapter 8, verses 7, 9, and 13 to 15. And the Gospel reading is from Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 to 43. Thanks for joining today's Mass Readings and Reflections. If you are new to this channel, please consider subscribing to this channel. First reading from the Book of Wisdom, chapter 1, verses 13 to 15, and chapter 2, verses 23 to 24. God did not make death, and He does not delight in the death of the living. For He created all things that they might exist, and the creatures of the world are wholesome, and there is no destructive poison in them, and the dominion of Hades is not on earth. For righteousness is immortal, for God created man for incorruption, and made him in the image of His own eternity. But through the devil's envy, death entered the world, and those who belong to his party experience it. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Response, O real Son. Your response: I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. I will extol you, O Lord, for you drew me clear and did not let my enemies rejoice over me. O Lord, you brought me up from the netherworld. You preserve me from among those going down into the pit. Your response: I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. Sing praise to the Lord, you His faithful ones, and give thanks to His holy name. For His anger lasts but a moment, a lifetime His goodwill. At nightfall weeping enters in, but with the dawn rejoicing. Your response: I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. Hear, O Lord, and have pity on me. O Lord, be my helper. You have changed my mourning into dancing. O Lord, my God, forever will I give you thanks. Your response: I will praise you, Lord, for you have rescued me. Second reading from St. Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 8, verses 7, 9, and 13 to 15. As you excel in everything, in faith, in utterance, in knowledge, in all earnestness, and in your love for us, see that you excel in this gracious work also. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sake He became poor, so that by His poverty you might become rich. I do not mean that others should be eased and you burdened, but that as a matter of equality, your abundance at the present time should supply their want, so that their abundance may supply your want, that there may be equality. As it is written, He who gathered much had nothing over. He who gathered little had no lack. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Gospel acclamation. Alleluia, alleluia. Our Savior Jesus Christ destroyed death and brought life to light through the Gospel. Alleluia, alleluia. Gospel reading is from Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 to 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about Him, and He was beside the sea. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name, and seeing Him, he fell at His feet and begged Him, saying, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her, so that she may be made well and live." And He went with him, and a great crowd followed Him and thronged about Him. And there was a woman who had had a flow of blood for 12 years, and who had suffered much under many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard the reports about Jesus, and came up behind Him in the crowd and touched His garment. For she said, "If I touch even His garments, I shall be made well." And immediately the hemorrhage ceased, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. And Jesus, perceiving in Himself that power had gone forth from Him, immediately turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And his disciples said to him, You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, Who touched me? And he looked around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had been done to her, came in fear and trembling, and fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. And he said to her, Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace, and be healed of your disease. While he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further? But ignoring what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, Do not fear, only believe. And he allowed no one to follow him, except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, he saw a tumult, and people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, Why do you make a tumult and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him. But he put them all outside, and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him, and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, Talitha kum, which means, Little girl, I say to you, arise. And immediately the girl got up and walked, for she was 12 years old. And immediately they were overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this, and told them to give her something to eat. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Greetings, brothers and sisters. Today our thoughts are focused on the Gospel passage in which Jesus heals the daughter of Jairus and the woman with her flow of blood, both of whom serve as models of faith in Christ's omnipotence. According to the Gospel, only a miracle will be able to cure Jairus' daughter, who is on her deathbed, as well as heal this lady, who has done everything humanly possible to make her condition better. This woman was suffering from a medical condition that implied legal impurity in Leviticus chapter 15, verse 25. We read, If a woman has a discharge of blood for many days, not at the time of her impurity, or if she has a discharge beyond the time of her impurity, all the days of the discharge, she shall continue in uncleanness. As in the days of her impurity, she shall be unclean. Medical attention had failed to cure her. On the contrary, as the Gospel puts it so realistically, she was in worse shape than she had been in before the treatment. Additionally, she had to deal with the embarrassment of being considered unclean by the law, which had been a source of physical suffering for the previous 12 years. Not only did the Jews consider a woman in this position to be impure, but they also considered everything she touched to be impure as well. Because of this, the woman approached Jesus from behind in order to avoid being noticed by the crowds, and out of delicacy, only touched the hem of his garment. Her faith is strengthened by her expression of humility, as she is conscious of her ineligibility to come to close to our Savior. She put her hand on the hem of his garment. She approached him with a spirit of faith in her heart. She believed, and she realized she had been healed. In all that crowd pressing around him, only this woman actually touched Jesus. And she touched him not only with her hand, but with the faith she bore in her heart. Another event depicted in this Gospel is the resurrection of Jairus' daughter from death. The raising of Jairus' daughter, like all the Gospel miracles, demonstrates Christ's divinity. Only God is capable of performing miracles. Sometimes He does so directly, and other times He uses created things as a medium. The Old Testament emphasizes the exclusively divine nature of miracles, particularly the miracle of raising the dead. The Lord wills and brings to life. He brings down Sheol and raises up, because He has power over life and death. God also uses men to bring dead back to life in the Old Testament. The prophet Elijah revives the son of the widow of Sarepta by crying to the Lord. And Elisha convinces him to raise the Shunammite's son. In the New Testament, the apostles do not act on their own authority, but rather on that of Jesus, to whom they first offer fervent prayer. Peter raises a Christian woman named Tabitha from the dead in Joppa. And Paul in Troas raises Eutychus from the dead after he falls from a high window. Jesus makes no reference to a higher power. His authority is absolute. All he has to do is give the command, and the daughter of Jairus is restored to life. This demonstrates that he is God. Observing these passages, we can conclude that the Christian should always expect God to aid him in his efforts to attain sanctification. The majority of the time, God's assistance comes to us in an unspectacular manner. But we should never doubt that if it is necessary for our salvation, God will perform another miracle. However, we must keep in mind that what the Lord expects of us is that we carry out His will on a daily basis, no matter what. If we really want to be saved, then we should reach out in faith and touch the garment of Christ as well. We must establish contact with Jesus. We have been provided with no other means of salvation available to us on earth. When we receive Jesus Christ in the Holy Eucharist, we have this physical contact with Him because of the sacramental species that are present. If these encounters with our Lord are to result in our salvation, it is also necessary for us to rekindle our faith. I am interested in hearing your comments on the readings for today. Please let us know what you think in the comments box below. Thank you. Remember to like the video and share it with your friends and family. May God bless you all.